Get your glasses
and your mask. Yeah, and they both were sick. She was sick first, and then tested her the other day, and she was positive. And of course, yeah. So they're both positive, and they're both sick. And of course, she's in the last minutes of the pregnancy, so, you know, she said she's been very faithful. She said they started the pregnancy with the flu. But the only thing is, they want to be open, because if they still are positive, they won't let them be with the baby. They'll take the baby.
Does everyone have a communion cup? Would you take one back to there?
Yeah, I was gonna take it to the bar.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
What a wonderful morning it is to be in the house of the Lord. Here's some announcements to go through quickly. And one is, in your pew, you'll see a light blue colored card. It's a prayer request card. If you or someone you know needs to be lifted up in prayer, you can just take this, fill it out, and put it in your offering plate as you exit the building. We have a group of people who come to pray specifically over requests. Also, August, the giving tree for August, is for Real Life Children's Ranch. So they are collecting paper towels and toilet paper. So if you so feel led by the Lord in supporting Real Life's Children's Ranch, and next time you go to the store, if you can buy an extra roll of paper towels or toilet paper and bring that to the church, they will be receiving that at the end of August. Also, today is Communion Sunday, and if you have not received a communion cup, Joe Spangler in the back here will be giving you a communion cup when you raise your hand. So anybody needs to raise their hand that they have not received one, Joe will be able to take care of that for you as well. Also, at the end of the service, between 11 and 11:30, we are having drive-through communion. So if you are out there in Facebook land watching our service live streaming, well, you can stop by the church in the back parking lot between 11 and 11:30, and we will have drive-through communion for you. And if you want to take communion at home while we're watching, just get yourself something that's the equivalent of bread and grape juice or whatever you need to. You may participate with us at home as well. And those are our announcements for this morning.
Our opening hymn is on page 64, Holy, Holy, Holy. You may stay seated, and please keep your masks on if you sing.
Chris's wife is in Chantel, and we want to lift her and Chris up in our prayers, and continue to pray that she can be healed and that God's will be done. So let's go to our Heavenly Father this morning in prayer. Father God, we thank you for you. You're the God that created everything. You're the God who in eternity stopped in a moment and said, I'm going to create a world. I'm going to create a universe. I'm going to create a people. I'm going to love them. And I'm going to provide for them. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. And Lord, because of our disobedience, we have ignored your perfect world. And now we live in a fallen world, in a fallen state of mankind. And Lord, now we have to deal with sin on a daily basis. And Lord, even though your provisions are always there before us, many of us cannot see the need for them. They ignore them, or they don't acknowledge them. Lord, put in our hearts this morning a desire to worship you in truth and in love. Put in our hearts a desire of repentance. Lord, to live the life that becomes the gospel. For you are the God that provided your own Son to die on the cross for our sins. We can never ask for more than what you have already done. Even in our disobedience, you show the agape love that is an example for all of us to show to one another. Heavenly Father, in times like these that we live, where there is so disharmony among people, Lord, we pray for the truth of your love to give us the harmony that God intended for us to have. Lord, may we treat one another with love and respect, even if we disagree. But Lord, may we, as a people, learn most importantly, we don't know how to do that unless we first come to you and accept your love of your Son dying for our sins. Heavenly Father, if there are those who are here this morning who have not heard the message that Jesus loves and Jesus saves, I ask that you prepare their hearts for it. Heavenly Father, we are grateful for the many blessings you bestow upon us in this great country that we live in. And Heavenly Father, we pray for our president. We pray for our governor, and we pray for our mayor, and also men and women who make decisions for us, that we continue to be one nation under God. And that God is Jesus the Christ. Heavenly Father, we pray for our military, those who have served, those who are serving, for we have been blessed by their service. We lift up to you, Heavenly Father, those who are sick. We lift up to you, Ernie and Satara. We lift up to you, Lord, ministries that are in need, people who are going through relationship issues. Heavenly Father, you know the need of each and every one of us, and we ask that you prepare our hearts for it. During an election season, especially the local elections that are coming up, Lord, I pray that you put in our hearts a desire to get out and vote. Get out and Lord, let your voice be heard. Put it in us, Lord, a desire to elect people who are godly, to elect people who you can work with. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this church and its many facets of ministries. We pray for our children's ministry, our youth, our young adult ministries, Lord, our adult ministries. Lord, continue to mold us into the people that you need for us to be. For we will never find a happy life if we do not find that life in you. Lord, open our hearts and our minds, not to the world, but to the gospel of Jesus Christ, that we may be the people that you have created for us to be. We thank for our pastor and his family, Lord. We pray for your love and your hand to be upon them, Lord, and that we continue, Lord, to be directed and be in the church that you need for us to be. Lord, put in our hearts a desire to not be a church of status quo, but to be a church, Lord, that pushes the boundaries of sin away from the church, away from our community and in our home life. Heavenly Father, we ask that you also teach us your word, that it may be written in our hearts, Lord, that we do not move away from it. Lord, we may see and meet every day that we wake up, and that need is Jesus the Christ, living big in us. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your Son who went to the cross, who bore our pain and shame. And Lord, who have provided everything for us, we just turn to him and not to ourselves, but to him, and allow him to lead in our hearts. Lord, this is our prayer this morning, and we offer it up to you that we may worship you in truth and love, in Jesus' name. And everyone said,
amen.
Thank you.
Make them be for us the the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now with the confidence of children of God, let us pray the prayer Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
All you have to do is remove the clear cellophane, pull out the wafer. You hold it with me. Jesus is the bread of life. This is his body that's been given for you. Take heed and remember this of him. And all of God's people said,
Amen. Now we can lift the purple seal. I never imagined this would be part of my communion instructions. The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Take and drink in remembrance of Christ's love and rejoice. And all God's people said, Amen. We're back in the book of Matthew, chapter 14. Starting in verse 22. Immediately, Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead of him to the other side, while he dismissed the crowd. After he had dismissed them, he went up on a mountainside by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But the boat was already a considerable distance from the land, buffeted by the waves because the wind was against it. During the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went out to them, walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. "It's a ghost," they said, and cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, "Take courage, it is I. Don't be afraid." "Lord, if it is you," Peter replied, "tell me to come to you on the water." "Come," he said. Then Peter got out of the boat, walked on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid. Beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Immediately, Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. "You have little faith," he said. "Why did you doubt?" And when they climbed into the boat, the wind died down. Then those who were in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly you are the Son of God." May God help us in the reading and hearing of God's holy word. This segment of scripture began with a retreat. Jesus retreated with the disciples to a lonely place, only to find that the crowds had gone on before them and were waiting for him. The scriptures say that Jesus had compassion on them and taught them. And then, as it was going toward evening, he suggested to the disciples that they feed them. We have the story of the feeding of the 5,000. A retreat interrupted. How many of us have been on a retreat, a church camp, a getaway, an office retreat of some sort? Most of us have been somewhere along the way in one of those kinds of events. It's a getaway for everyone except the retreat leader. Someone has to come up with the program that's going to be done. Joy has been on a number of retreats, and as much as she enjoys them, she works like mad ahead of time, getting either the music together, the devotions, and different things that are needed. They've got a whole team that do the minister's mates retreats so that no one person bears the full brunt of the preparation. But at some level, it's not a retreat for the one who's in charge. I don't think Jesus had high expectations of his ability to get away. This was a retreat for the disciples. They had just come off of them having been sent out, and so it was kind of going to be, I suspect, a debrief, you know. Okay, how did it go? What went well? What didn't work? And all of that came crashing down because there were these crowds of people, thousands of people. We always call it the feeding of the 5,000. But the scripture says there were 5,000 men and women and children. It was probably the feeding of the 12,000, 13,000. It was a wonderful miracle. It would have followed in last week's gospel to have done that reading with our communion, which always feels kind of exciting to me when the scriptures fall on the first Sunday of the month. We have the feeding of the 5,000, and then we have Holy Communion all on the same Sunday. Well, with the storm, it didn't work out for last week. We realized that we shouldn't probably put the little tent up in the parking lot and have people exposed to the wind and rain. And so we put off communion till this week. I'm not sure that I've ever done that before. And I was going to miss out on communion, which really bothered me. We were back in town last Sunday. We got chased out of South Florida, partly by the storm and partly by a little medical issue. Joy had an infection in her thumb. And we decided that we'd be safer up in Okeechobee. So we came home and we got her some treatment, and it has cleared up. But it was I still kind of was torn whether to come to church last week or not, because I was back in town and I could have made it. Heck, we could have made it by getting up as early as we did from the condo and still been back on Sunday morning. But I felt like, well, it's vacation. This is my Sunday to be away. So we watched the service last week on YouTube or on Facebook Live. And it was a very satisfying service. It wasn't the same as being here. You can't. I'm still torn every week about the opportunity of being present with you in worship. And the need still to take care of ourselves in the midst of the pandemic. Our numbers continue to go up. Deaths have gone up in Okeechobee. We held out for the longest time without an official death here in Okeechobee. And now I think we're up to 9 that have passed away because of the infection. And I don't want church to be the place where anyone gets sick or exposed to the illness. Most of us, with a few exceptions, are in the high risk category. And so we do the best we can staying away. So last week we stayed away and took the Sunday off. And today we had our Holy Communion. And Jesus sent the disciples on the boat. Go ahead of me to the other side. And then Jesus dismissed the crowd and went up on the mountain to pray. Jesus needed that time after the feeding of the 5,000. I can't help but imagine that in some way he was drained by that experience. He needed time with God. Time not with the disciples hanging around, watching his every move. Just time to be alone, to pray, to commune with God. We call it communion because it opens us to the presence of God. And Jesus spent the bulk of the night praying. I had the privilege of going to Israel in 1986. We took a boat ride on the Sea of Galilee. That's like a mandatory part of going out on a Holy Land trip. You've got to go out on the Sea of Galilee. And so we went out on the boat and they began to read scriptures that dealt with the Sea of Galilee. And there was this storm cloud that came up over Magdala. and the sky is clear, it's beautiful, and our guide says, we must go in, a storm is coming. It's like, that's way over there. I can see the cloud. And it's not a very big cloud. And I'm thinking, we've got an hour or 2 hours or three before a storm comes. Probably 5 minutes later, the cloud is over us, and the water that had been so still and beautiful, and we're having scripture read about Jesus on the sea and just some of the different incidents that happened, and all of a sudden there's a chop on the water and the wind started to blow. And our boat, thankfully, was not a Galilean boat from 2,000 years ago. It had an engine, and the guy had it full out, going in for shore, and we're just hopping along into Capernaum. And just as we arrived, the heavens opened up. And I remember scattering out of the boat in the rain and looking back on the sea and thinking, wow, we were out there just a moment ago and it was glassy calm. And here the wind and the rain and the waves. This is what the disciples faced that evening. The wind was against them. In a square-sailed boat, you can't go anywhere when the wind is against you. They would have had to take the sail down and then the oars, trying to row against that wind. And they would have gone probably not much of anywhere once the storm came up. Just to make any headway, they had to keep paddling. And into that howling storm, Jesus came walking. The storm doesn't calm down until after Jesus is in the boat. The wind and the waves were all still going. They thought, it's a ghost. And Jesus said, it is I. Take courage. Don't be afraid. We need to hear those words, even in the midst of the pandemic. Jesus is with us. We need to take courage. It doesn't mean that we need to dispense with masks or hand washing or anything else. But we need to take courage to know that Christ is still with us. Whether we face the illness, whether we avoid it altogether, we need to have courage. Take courage from the one who is our strength, our hope, and our Redeemer. It is a scary time for a lot of people. Many are not going out any more than they have to. I think today is the fullest church has been since all this got going. And it's half what we would have had on a normal Sunday this time of year. But we need to take all the precautions that are recommended, to do everything we can to take care of ourselves and to take care of others, because none of us are on an island to ourselves. We always have contact with others. So if we keep ourselves healthy, we can keep others healthy as well. We need to take courage and not be afraid. Whether in life or in death, Christ is with us. We do not need to live in fear. Maybe to live in caution. We don't need to live in fear, because He will be with us. Whatever happens, whatever comes. But that's not the end of the story. Peter, as was his wont, spoke up when everybody else is still on the ghost theme. "Lord, if it is you, tell me to come out of the boat." "Come to you on the water." We kind of criticize Peter for being out there verbally so much of the time. "Though everyone deny you, I will never deny you. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Peter was always out there. And Peter got out of the boat. And we always think of him sinking as the outcome of the story. But the scriptures say that Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water, and came toward Jesus. That is faith. Faith to take the chance to get out of the boat. I don't know what Christ may be calling us to get out of the boat this morning. But we need to step out on faith. And we may be like Peter and find that the wind is too much. I've always pictured this, that as long as he had eye contact with Jesus, he was okay. As long as his focus was on the Lord, he was walking on the water. He was making headway until he got distracted by the wind. And then, once he looked away from Jesus, that was all it took. He began to go under. this is not still water. This isn't something that you just go under and not to worry, you can swim. It's not clear that Peter could swim. Well, it is later. But in the midst of the storm, all Peter could do is cry out, Lord, save me. And Jesus was there, lifted him out of the water and into the boat, and then Jesus stepped onto the boat. This is a miracle. It's a miracle that Jesus came walking to them on the water. It's a miracle that Peter walked toward Jesus on the water. And it's a miracle that Jesus was able to lift Peter up while on the water and help him into the boat. And then Jesus got into the boat. And the wind died down. Then those who were on the boat worshipped him, saying, Truly you are the Son of God. It was chapters earlier, months earlier, when Peter made his declaration, You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Now they're all on board with it. I don't know what kind of miracle will take in our lives for us to step out in faith in whatever area God is calling you. But as long as we keep our eyes on Him, as long as our focus is on Christ, we'll be able to do whatever He's called us to do. And when the wind distracts us, He'll be there to lift us up again.
I'm certainly stepping out of the boat this morning. The waves can represent a lot of distractions that we have that keep us from doing some of the things that we really want to do. So this morning I'm going to play a song called Oceans, and you'll get to hear what it's about. I will call upon
Bless, preserve, and keep us all now and forevermore. Amen.